Everyone to the ninth meeting of the Education and Skills Committee in 2017. And can I please remind everyone present to turn their mobile phones and other devices onto silent for the duration of the meeting. The first item of business is on the children's hearing system. Last week we held a round table on children's hearing, and one of the themes of the discussion was the role of solicitors in the system. The committee agreed it wanted to hear more on this subject, and I'm pleased to welcome to the meeting Morag, Family Law Subcommittee Convener in the Law Society of Scotland, and Mark Allison, Director of Livingstone Brown. Thank you both for coming at such short notice. Some of the main issues we explored last week were the advantages and disadvantages of the 2011 Act reforms and how these have affected the role of solicitors, the perception that the introduction of solicitors into the system has made the process more adversarial, and the training available to and registration process for solicitors to be involved in the hearing system. So I'll start with a general question on the first point about the advantages and disadvantages of the 2011 Act reforms and how these have affected the role of the solicitors. What is your view on the benefits and challenges of the changes to solicitors' role in the children's hearing system since the 2011 Act was implemented?
Well, I'll start for the two of us. I also have to say that not only have I've done work as a solicitor in hearings, I was also a children's reporter for 4 years, so I have seen it from the other side. My colleague will be talking more about current practice in the hearings, but I think part of the advantage of the Act is that it has clarified when solicitors should be present in hearings, because they're certainly not required at every hearing. It's a minimum number of hearings, and it also guarantees that the system is compliant with the UNCRC and the ECHR, and I don't think we can underestimate the importance of that. Much of the stuff that came into the Act about solicitors was as a result of case law that had found that when parents or children were not represented, their rights, their human rights, were not being safeguarded. So it is a way that has made our system more compliant without turning it into a courtroom formal adversarial system. And my colleague will talk more about current practice for solicitors and the active role that is now being played.
Ultimately, the question is, what is the role of the solicitor? And I think the important point is, we are there to ensure whoever we are representing effectively participate. The cases where concern has been raised is really in relation to a very small minority of cases, and we're talking about contentious and adversarial cases, but there is a perception that solicitors are making cases adversarial, whereas it may actually be the case that because we're talking about the contentious cases, really, to look at it another way, that's where there is a need for there to have a solicitor involved to represent these people. That the people who we represent are generally parents, children, or carers. So it's not just parents, but people who have decided they feel they need a solicitor to be able to participate. So we don't appoint ourselves, we don't tout to represent people. It is about people making that choice that they feel they cannot effectively participate without having a solicitor. So we are there to ensure that happens. We are there to ensure that happens consistent with the ethos. But as Morag has said, there is already regulation of that to ensure that happens. But we're also there to ensure that our clients' rights are respected, whether that be the parent, whether that be the child, or whether that be another person who we're representing at the hearing.
I know there's going to be a number of questions coming from my colleagues, but one of the things that, I do accept that the figure that was mooted last week was 10% of cases involved solicitors, of hearing, and I suspect that only a smaller percentage of that will be the ones that are contentious and the ones that they were sort of brought to their attention last week. But there did seem to be this perception that in some cases it was a child against the world, and the whole children's hearing system was not meant to be like that. It was meant to be the other way, and that was because of solicitors that were there with parents and others. So
I have sat through over 1,000 hearings, and believe me, they can be very contentious without anybody in the room, apart from me, having any legal qualifications whatsoever. If you look at when legal aid is available for children's hearings work, actually children's legal aid, it's very limited. Children get automatic legal aid only when they are facing very severe interference with their lives, when they're facing going into secure accommodation. We would never put an adult in a situation where they were deprived of their liberty without having legal representation. why would it be tolerable for children? When a child has been arrested or detained and is being kept in a police station or other place of safety, they must come to a hearing. If that was done to an adult, would we even contemplate denying them legal representation because it might turn things contentious?
I mean, I don't think that the committee at this stage is saying that, that the legal representation shouldn't be there.
No, if you could let me finish. These, and at the second working day hearing after child protection order, those are the only instances where legal aid is given automatically to the child. In every other case, when legal aid is available, it has to pass the Scottish Legal Aid Board's merits test, apart from a very small number of cases where it's a means test. So it has already been looked at. Is it justifiable to spend public funds on having legal representation? We have to be very careful. You have a right to a representative. It doesn't have to be a lawyer. It can be your Auntie Jeannie. It can be an advocacy worker. We have already accepted that somebody going to a hearing, whether it's about themselves or their child, should have somebody there to back them up. And the role of the lawyer in the hearing is actually no different. It comes under the same definition. So it's to assist the accompanied person to discuss issues arising for discussion. Now, some of those issues require legal tests to be applied. And then, yes, it can be a legal discussion, but it doesn't mean, my lord, I put it to you. It's not that sort of thing. And yes, we do, we are required to follow the ethos of the hearings. The Legal Aid Board requires lawyers who want to do this work to register, to have the competencies, to follow the ethos, and they are monitored. If panel members, in my experience, don't tend to be pushovers, they don't tend to be easily intimidated, they tend to be very dedicated to the work they're doing. Kenneth Norrie once at a conference said, if the solicitor is getting a bit legal, tell him to shut up. I think maybe there's a training issue to give panel members more confidence to be able to say, calm down a bit, it's getting legal. But all of the stuff, ladies and gentlemen, is already there.
Okay. You're talking about adversarial. I don't want this to be adversarial today.
I'm sorry, I'm just passionate about the hearing system.
This is about us asking questions about the benefits of the amount of solicitors that seem to be appearing at children's hearings, and if there's a better way to do it than the way it's done at present without the child being seen not to be represented by a solicitor or anybody else as appropriate. Daniel, then Colin, then Liz.
I'd just like to explore a couple of the words that both of you have been using. I think the reason we've got concern is that the fundamental underlying ethos of the panels is that it's meant to be a context which is less intimidating, is about bringing out the voices, especially of children, but to some extent also parents. And you've talked about lawyers' roles about being enabling people to participate and to assist those there. But it strikes me that the concept of representation doesn't always mean that. It means that someone's speaking in place of somebody else. So is there a potential issue here where lawyers' voices are being heard rather than those of parents, children? Is that a problem? Are there things that can be done or should be done in order to change that model, maybe advice provided to solicitors? And ultimately, how do we ensure that solicitors don't end up being proxies for the people who are at the panel, and ultimately who the panel is meant to be there to enable their voices to be heard rather than having the voices of a proxy heard?
Well, I think in terms of the role of solicitors, I think we have to remember largely the people we are representing are very vulnerable people. So these are people who already have limitations arising from their circumstances about their ability to play this role themselves. And as I said, and I made the point earlier and I reiterated again, often we come in to a case because they have chosen that they feel they can't do that role themselves. They need the benefit of representation. Now, we are not there as a substitute. If I attend a hearing, and I attend many hearings at ground level, I do not spend my time speaking simply for my client and not allowing them to speak. speak. It is about them being able to say what they feel they can see and feeling empowered, but it is about us filling in any gaps or blanks there may be. And I think it also has to be remembered that the work solicitors do isn't confined to the four walls of the children's hearing room. We do a great deal of work to assist our clients in effectively participating, but to assist them in focusing on what's in the child's best interest before we get to the stage of them attending the hearing, because they get large volumes of documents through that many of them can't properly digest. They have particular issues that may or may not be central or relevant, which they want to raise. So we have to spend a great deal of time enabling them to participate when they get to a hearing, which normally is only set down for a short period of time of 45 minutes. And I think it's worth bearing in mind that when we approach a hearing, the panel members are obviously informed as far as they can be of the circumstances before they arrive. But what they are informed based upon is a bundle of papers which largely consists of the procedural history and a social work report. So they don't know any detail of what the parent's position is. They don't know where there's a dispute in fact. They don't know where there are legal issues. And therefore, we have a great difficulty, but it's something we have to do to ensure that those issues where they should properly be made are being raised, but ensuring we're doing that in a way which doesn't prejudice the overall ethos. So in my view, the role of a solicitor is central. It is not about whether we need solicitors. The conversation should really be about how we ensure everyone is participating in a collective way, which is always welfare-centric.
So if I can just ask a quick follow-up. So I think that last point you made is absolutely right. Is that consistently held, that approach by solicitors? Is there a need to sort of ensure that there's a consistency? And then my second point is, you're absolutely right about the vulnerability of these people, but if you've got a room full of 20 professionals, does that actually help those people who are vulnerable, who might find it difficult, who might find a courtroom intimidating? And is there an issue that actually, as well-intended as this might be, that actually the just the sheer number of people in the room actually is acting against that drive to provide a context for hearing people's voices?
In terms of the former of the two issues you asked, I would hope that's a widely held view, because that is what the registration criteria for the Legal Aid Board, for example, tells us everyone must be signing up to that and must be committing to that. Most of this work is legally aided, and again, that tells us something about the circumstances, without being pejorative, of the people who require the benefit of this representation by and large. So I would hope that everyone is signing up to that. That is a question, I think, if there is a concern about that, of training. But it's not simply training about solicitors, in my view. There seems to be a concern that if we take solicitors representing parents as the example, there is an assumed conflict between the interests of the child on the one hand and the interests of the parent. And I think that's fundamentally the wrong approach. The 2011 Act is a very carefully constructed piece of legislation that is comprehensive, sets out various legal principles, but with the underlying principle of the child's welfare. So the child's welfare is not a separate concept. One arrives at the view of what's in a child's best interest when one goes through the proper process with everyone effectively participating, applying the correct legal test, and then arriving at the best conclusion we can. Because if one simply takes a subjective view of what's in a child's best interest, I may have a different view, Morag may have a different view, you, Mr. Convener, may have a different view. And that's why the legislation is crafted in the way it is. So I have a concern that there's an approach that because solicitors are advocating a different position, they are inherently acting contrary to the welfare of a child. That's not the case in my respectful view. One should determine what's in the best interest of a child at the end of the process. So that's what I would wish to say about the former. I don't know if Morag wants to deal with the second issue.
Yeah,
Colin, and then you can respond to...
Oh, I was just going to deal with the second part of the question about the number of people in the room.
Okay, right.
The rules of procedure, the statutory instrument, is very helpful on this point. The chairing member, according to Rule 6, has a duty to make sure that the number of people in the room at any one time is kept to the minimum. And this is something that could be used much more creatively to say, how many of these people actually need to be here? Do we need three social workers plus a lawyer for the social worker, which is a trend that is becoming slightly worrying? So it's already there. We have a lot, the Act and the statutory instruments are something that we should all be slightly smug about in Scotland, because I think they do give us quite a good system.
Okay, the Con.
Thank you, Vera.
During the last
session of Parliament, we had some quite good sessions on this and took quite a bit of evidence on it. And the evidence seems fairly consistent. We spoke to young people who had been through the system, who had experienced being at hearings where lawyers were present, and they felt that they were talked over, that their voice was not heard, and that was 100% of them felt that. There was concerns raised by a number of people who served on these panels who felt that there was a degree of intimidation from lawyers being present. They felt that they did not have the legal experience and that the lawyers, and the whole thing ended up the parents fighting over the child, but the child not be, child's rights and so on not being considered adequately. What would you say to that?
Well, I can understand. I think we have partly a problem in that there is a general distrust of the profession and perhaps a lack of understanding of what lawyers do. A lot of this, and the Celsus report, I think, is quite helpful in some respects, that joint training between lawyers, social workers, panel members, all the participants would be helpful. Also, we, and you are looking now at making advocacy for children much more widely available and to a professional standard. And yes, children do get talked over, but that happens in hearings when there is no lawyer present as well. The role of the advocacy worker, I don't think, can be underestimated in keeping the child informed, participating, and not feeling like the bone between the dogs.
But consistent evidence seems to point to quite a number of the participants having concerns about lawyers being present, because it ends up as in an adversarial situation where the lawyers are defending the rights of the parents and so on, and the child is left swinging in the middle there. How do you avoid that?
I attend many hearings, and I have to say that's not what I see at ground level, and I wonder how many of the people who've given evidence actually physically attend the hearings and see what happens at ground level. There are the vast majority of hearings we already know happen without a lawyer being present. The vast majority of hearings which I and my colleagues attend, we are the biggest providers of children's legal aid in Scotland. We don't just represent parents, we represent children as well. So there, I have a significant evidence base on which to comment, and the vast majority of hearings we attend are not conducted in that way. So there may be an issue with training, but I agree with Morag that I think there is a distrust of the profession, and there's perhaps a lack of mutual understanding of all of the participants of the different roles everyone plays. Again, I'm not sure the solution to ensuring a child is effectively participating in a process is to remove the right of effective participation from someone else. It's about how we make these things work together in a way where one doesn't inhibit the other.
In the Law Society's submission, there is a very clear statement which says the presence of solicitors does not create an adversarial forum. But evidence seems to indicate that quite a number of people who participate, including the children, feel otherwise.
Well, do you not think, sir, that the role of the chairing member of the hearing is pivotal in this? The chairing member is given a considerable responsibility for the running of a hearing. If chairing members are feeling intimidated by people at hearings, then perhaps there's a perception difficulty, but I think perhaps the training of the panel members could be improved to give them the courage to say to the lawyer, excuse me, Ms. Driscoll, this is not an adversarial process. Could you back down a bit?
Just one last question. In your submission, it's the final question there. What is your view on the interaction between children's hearings and the courts, and can improvements be made on how they work together? You said the subcommittee is not in a position to respond.
Well, we don't have the... We're not in a position to go out and see how it is working. We don't have the resources to go and look at that, which is why we did not respond to that. That's a matter for research and people that have the skills to look at that. If you're talking about how it works from the point of view of the profession, then you're looking at, we have a good division of responsibility that we don't make hearings decide evidential issues. we don't make hearings do their own appeals. And in that, I think my colleague will be better prepared than I, because I no longer go in to court these days. It's quite clear. We have sheriffs who are very much aware and in support of the hearing system. They don't override hearings, they'll send it back. I think, to me, that works fairly well. But at the Law Society, we could not go back and say, yes, because X, Y, and Z. So that's why we didn't answer it. But you're doing it.
Yeah. Well, I certainly think whether it's something that's not already there or not, I don't know, but there certainly needs to be a proper understanding of the different roles and a proper interrelationship, because from a child's point of view, this is all part of the one process. Albeit they only attend the children's hearings, they do have a right to attend court if they wish. They can be represented in that process, but it is all part of the one process, and there are things which could be done to improve it. For example, I principally practice in the Glasgow jurisdiction, and in Glasgow we have a dedicated what we call a children's referral court. So it's specific solicitors that deal with this who build up specific experience in this field. There's a specific practice note which has rules. The number one rule set out in it is that the rest of the rules are in accordance with and have been set down in accordance with what is considered to be in the child's best interest. So there's very much a focus, and there can be. I can't see anything wrong, and indeed I can only see benefit from that approach being taken on a wider basis, but that's something we've chosen to do in Glasgow because there isn't specific provision for that in terms of the legislation. So that's a way in which I can see it can assist, because I think to have a proper understanding of whether a solicitor is assisting or hampering a children's hearing, one has to have a proper understanding of how a children's hearing works and what happens in practice.
Thank you. Liz?
Thank you. As you know, the children's hearing system has been very much part of the deliberations of successive education committees in this Parliament for the best part of 10 years. And I think the challenge that we have as parliamentarians is to know whether the 2011 legislation is fit for purpose. And the general opinion, I think, the feedback is, yes, it is. But I'd be interested to know if you confirm that view or whether you would like any changes to it, or whether we have got the guidance wrong, or whether there's nothing wrong with either the legislation or the guidance, and we have to do something either through training, just as you've mentioned, or through other aspects. I think that's the crucial challenge that we face as parliamentarians, to try to improve matters on behalf of those who are seeking assistance. And I'd be very interested in your views on that.
Well, it is a very interesting act. It's a very complex, as one of the people who has been annotating it, it is a very intricate and quite subtle piece of legislation. No piece of legislation is ever perfect from the day it is passed and will last in a state of admirable perfection forever. There are always tweakings and adjustments needed. I think one of the things from point of view of the child is we need perhaps to strengthen the guidance for panel chairs on keeping the numbers smaller. Yes, sometimes we have a lot of professionals, but do we need more than one representative from each? You know, we need three social workers, two teachers. Can we ask some people to leave the room for a bit? Can we perhaps look again? The Act does not define attendance at a hearing as being in person.
That was deliberate, though.
Yes. The statutory instrument allowing a child to attend remotely only allows to attend remotely if they have been excused. And I think that perhaps it is worth revisiting that, because if a child would normally meet the criteria for being excused because of the distressing nature of the grounds or because of fear, if it's the grounds hearing and they can understand the explanation, we make them go. They can't be excused. But could we not allow them to attend that part of the grounds hearing remotely? Could we not make better use? Because, you know, it's easier to ignore a child in a chair than it is a child on a television screen. You're more aware of the person that's there. If you've ever done, you know, Skype meetings and things, you're more aware. You watch the faces on the screens because you know the person isn't in the room. I think we've got it there, but I think making a child attend a grounds hearing who would normally be excused because they were so frightened of going, why are we doing that? Could we not, the kernel is there. Could we not examine that a bit more? I know that the Reporters Administration is very much supportive of anything that will help a child give a view. And I'm assisting an advocacy organization now that is actively looking at the child recording what they want the hearing to say that could be played on a screen. So everybody really would have to listen. You know, there are things we can do so the child doesn't have to remember. Mum could do it. The lawyer could help them do it so it could be played at a hearing. We could make more use of the technology that we have. It's there, but we just need to, as you say, focus on what would help. I don't think there's a lot of legislative change that's needed, but guidance, ethos of also accepting that lawyers do care about this system. They do want best outcomes for children. You don't do this work unless you believe in the system.
I'm sure that's the case. I don't think anybody would doubt that for a second.
No, so, I'm fine to say that. Back?
Thank you. Gillian?
Just coming back to the issue of training, I really want to ask this simple question. What additional training, if any, is required for solicitors getting into this work in children's panels? Is there any provision, or is it all voluntary?
There is a set of what are called competences criteria that require to be met, and you have to establish that you meet all of those in each of those, and there's a continuing scheme, and I think there's a more extensive scheme being introduced by the Scottish Legal Aid Board about how one satisfies those competences and review of that on an ongoing basis. So there is quite a strict and rigid regime. I think what is missing in terms of training, and we're focusing on training for solicitors, but I think the focus should be on multidisciplinary training for everyone, because in the way that one might say, in some cases, there's ignorance on the part of a particular solicitor about the approach a social work take or the approach a child psychologist takes or another professional takes, I think there is sometimes also an ignorance and almost a hostility towards the approach that a solicitor takes. And I have to stress, we're talking about a very small minority of cases whenever we're talking about these concerns. But I think the way in which we get to the bottom of that might be compulsory multidisciplinary training, which involved everyone in effect getting a shared understanding of what the respective roles are around children's hearings, because I think that's missing. There's no requirement for that. I, as a solicitor, because I practice in this field, contrary to what other evidence may have suggested, do have an understanding of matters relating to the consequences of emotional trauma for children, the consequences of child protection issues for children, the consequences of other psychological issues that may develop, because I deal with this work constantly. But those of my colleagues that don't deal with it as frequently may not have the benefit of that, and there may be a lack of understanding. And equally, when I'm talking about other disciplines requiring to have the same understanding of solicitors, there are very, very good panel members, there are very, very good social workers, there are very, very good third-party agency representatives. It's all about achieving consistency, I think. And I think that's where the issue is. We're focusing on the negatives, perhaps to the exclusion of the positives. But I think to ensure that there's more consistency, we need training, but across the board. And I think the starting point from the perspective of solicitors is an acceptance and appreciation that the role of solicitors is a benefit. Once we have that acceptance, then I think we can take that forward in terms of ensuring the way we participate guarantees that benefit in the best way possible for that child.
I mean, you're talking about the competencies and review on those competencies. Could you tell the committee how that's done? How, if there was an issue with a solicitor maybe not meeting those competencies, how that would be reviewed, how somebody could actually report that, what would be done in that circumstance?
Well, there's really three elements. One requires to make an application to the Scottish Legal Aid Board to be put on the scheme in the first place. So they have to be persuaded in the first instance that you meet that. So you would only be on the scheme if you meet that test. Now, in terms of ad hoc issues which might call into question whether you are continuing to fulfil those competences, there is a scheme of complaints. There is information being disseminated about that. And obviously, the complaints should really be the last port of calling. But there is that scheme for those more extreme cases where there is a real genuine concern about that. The Scottish Legal Aid Board have now introduced a regime of automatic checks. So every few years, they will automatically review files. They will have peer review. They will have a particular person coming in to ensure that you are continuing to meet those competences. And the Scottish Legal Aid Board is at liberty to deregister you at any point if they consider you're not meeting those competences. Now, it may be that has to be more structured, but as I understand it, they're already taking steps. Mm-hmm. What I would say is that we're talking, by and large, because it's the majority of the way in which this work is done, legal aid cases. There's obviously not the same regime available for non-legal aid cases. Representation by persons doesn't have to be through legal aid, but most of it is funded that way. So that may be, Morag may be able to talk about if there is a gap and how that can be filled, but I think that's perhaps an issue to ensure it's across the board.
So you could have a solicitor there that's not doing it through legal aid, who will not have to conform to these competencies. Is that, am I understanding you correctly?
The exceedingly rare situation where a parent is paying legal fees themselves. Chances are, you see, though, that the solicitor who's doing that work is also registered with Scottish Legal Aid Board, because it would be unusual for a solicitor that does other things to suddenly pitch up at a children's hearing, because one doesn't. It's working outside your area. So if my colleague was approached by somebody who was a private client, didn't qualify for legal aid on means, they'd be getting a solicitor who was registered on the scheme anyway.
But
if you wish to approach the Law Society, we wouldn't want to end up with a double registration scheme where you had to register with the Legal Aid Board and register with the Law Society and have two competing schemes. That, I think, would be unworkable. And you're getting into...
Excuse me a second, but surely the issue here is not that you're registered with the Law Society, you're registered with the Legal Aid Board, but I think the point that Gillian's making is that you're registered in some way that makes you capable of dealing with these...
Yeah.
You have the special training and knowledge to deal with these specific types of cases. So surely the solution isn't that it's Legal Aid Board or it's Law Society, it's that there's that sort of like theme of training before you're allowed to go in and represent a family at a children's hearing.
I think the reason why the issue perhaps hasn't received a lot of focus is, as Morag says, the number of occasions when someone will be privately fee-paying and be represented by a solicitor who's not already on the scheme are very few and far between, so that I have to say it very rarely arises. Interestingly, I can be quite clear with the committee that I, as a solicitor who practices almost exclusively in this work, do not want just any solicitor who deals with a different type of work coming in and dealing with this. I don't think that a solicitor who deals with the exclusively criminal work should come in and represent a parent, because they won't have an understanding of the ethos. In the same way, I don't think a criminal justice social worker should turn up at a children's hearing and make recommendations about what's in the best interest of a child. Of course, there has to be regulation. I think what Morag is suggesting is we would have a concern about over-regulation, but I, as a solicitor, and I don't think those in my profession who actively deal with this type of work on a day-to-day basis, we have no concern or fear about proper regulation. We feel we have that, but absolutely, if there's a more refined way to deal with that, we would have no difficulty with that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, yeah, thank you. Thank you.
One small thing about the joint training. The great advantage of having across-the-board training where all of the different parties train together is that you get to know one another. You no longer fear the lawyer you have sat in training with and seen them struggling to understand what you do and explaining what they do. There is an advantage to the social workers, the teachers, the health visitors, and everybody having training together, because you get to know each other. You're no longer that label in the chair, you're that person.
There was a lot of discussion about this last week that position was taken, I think, by most people around the table, that there would be benefits in that sort of multidisciplinary training. Tavish.
Thank you. Can I just further to Gillian's points? So it's not impossible for a solicitor to attend a children's panel hearing with none of the training you've described. I mean, if I as a parent decide I want my local solicitor to represent my interests at a children's panel hearing, and he or she has no training whatsoever in all the ways you've just described, there's nothing that stops that happening, is there?
Well,
I appreciate your point that it's very few cases.
There's nothing that stops a criminal lawyer from doing some conveyancing.
Well, indeed.
But you tend not to, because you value your insurance, your complaints history, and your professional standing.
Yeah, but I'm just for the record, there's nothing that actually stops that happening. Yeah, and you'd recognise, presumably, there's a geographic point here too, because I can take the point about Glasgow and Edinburgh. Mark Allison's obviously got a practice in Glasgow that does this work, but in lots of parts of Scotland, there just won't be this kind of expertise. Well,
don't talk rural solicitors down. I was one.
Well, I represent a rural constituency. Yeah. I've got lots of constituents who are affected in this area. My mum used to be the reporter to the panel, so I know this stuff. So yeah. I'm just saying, is there a difference between the kind of practice Mark Allison's describing and what may happen in different parts of the country?
I mean, certainly, I know it's not a complete solution, but firms such as mine do practice the length and breadth of Scotland, so it's not just Glasgow. I was using Glasgow as the example. There is a duty scheme for representation that comes through the children's hearing where someone is identified as requiring a representation but hasn't already got representation. And ironically, most of the referrals we get through that are from more rural constituencies rather than from Glasgow or Edinburgh or anything of that nature. We get a lot from Dumfries. We get a lot from the Highlands and Islands. So, and we get a lot of work which is referred to us from those areas. So I don't think it's a question of the training of the solicitors that are there, but because we're talking about very small bars of solicitors, there may not be that specialism. And again, I suppose that comes back to ensuring that there is proper representation and equal representation for everyone. But that may be an issue which can be looked at. But I don't think there's an issue in terms of the solicitors in other geographical locations being less qualified to do it. I think the issue is simply there are fewer of them,
sure.
Unfortunately.
Yeah, no, I agree with that. Just you mentioned the number of cases that legal aid is applied for and therefore eligible for in terms of the 10% of hearings that are where solicitors are present. Do you have any kind of number on that? I mean, are we talking 90% of that 10% are legal aid cases? Or less, or do you have any idea of how many it is? I think you said the majority in your...
Yes, I think in our practice it's probably something in that region, maybe 85 to 90% being legally aided. But obviously by the time we get to that funding, as Morag has pointed out, we've already had to address both a means and a merits test to justify
that. No, I understand that. The other question is your experience now that your firm may be representing our child or our parent, are there other solicitors at the same hearing representing other parties in that hearing?
There can be. The predominant people represented by solicitors are obviously the parents. The next group, I think, would be the child. There are representatives, for example, in Glasgow, we do direct adoption petitions rather than permanence orders with authority to adopt. That's the practice which the local authority takes. And often, therefore, when they refer the prospective adopters onto a particular solicitor, that solicitor will then attend at every single children's hearing for the prospective adopters, sometimes slightly unusually without the prospective adopters even being there.
Yes.
So there can be a scheme. I think, and I don't think it's something to be feared, but one of the areas where I feel that the system is perhaps lacking is a prioritisation of kinship placements, because the concern I have from the practice I do, and this comes back to your point, Tavish, about representation, that the concern I have is that kinship is often only viewed as a solution when we've absolutely excluded rehabilitation. So it's a long-term solution, and it's really thought of as a short-term solution whilst we are kind of inquiring as to whether parents can care for their children appropriately or whether there are issues. And I feel that's missing from the system, and the only circumstances in which those kind of relatives are able to participate is when they can show that they have significant involvement or have had significant involvement in recent times. So there is a small group of relatives such as grandparents or persons offering to be the alternative carer who aren't probably represented as often as they should be because they have a viable option. The legislation tells us, although it's not as expressly set out as perhaps it should be, that before one gets to long-term foster care, the port of call before that should be kinship.
Yeah.
So I think that is one area where I think there's a little bit of a lack of focus.
Yeah, that's helpful in terms of things to go forward with. But just on the point about solicitors being, or our solicitor being present at our hearing, representing, again, one party, is your experience now that can lead to one of the other parties, either the other set of parents or even the social work department, also having a solicitor? In other words, is the number of solicitors going to these hearings that you're describing fairly today growing?
Well, the starting point as to who has the right to be represented, and the legislation does set out who has the right to be represented, it is relevant persons and the child.
Sure.
I have had a handful of experiences in the Glasgow jurisdiction where the solicitor from the local council has appeared to represent the social worker, yeah. And I have a concern, and I've expressed a concern, because yeah. There's no automatic right for them to be represented, because a social worker, for example, attends a hearing as an information source. They are there to equip exactly. the hearing to make a decision, exactly. whereas a parent's involvement is slightly more complex mm-hmm. because they have their own rights that may or may not be in conflict with the child's interests. So I do have a concern. I think it is more of an issue, and Morag is aware of this being an issue in Edinburgh, because of a particular judgment which was issued arising from a finding of contempt in relation to a social worker. There is now very much focus and concern, I think, in that jurisdiction, certainly from Edinburgh City Council, about ensuring their social workers don't end up in that position mm. again. And I think it's an unfortunate consequence if the system is being used for them to be represented, because my view is they don't have a right to be yeah. represented at the hearing.
And I don't in any way want to put words into your mouth, but is the incidence of more than one party being represented legally at these small number of cases growing or not? Or do you think it's quite stable in that sense?
It's quite difficult, because we're looking at the system as if the 2011 Act introduced representation, and it didn't. It yeah. introduced funding for sure, representation. Sure. There yeah. was always representation. The issue was that there wasn't funding in every case, so there wasn't consistent representation. And I'm perhaps not well placed to comment on it, because we used to historically represent clients whether there was funding or not, because it was the part of the overall work we did. However, it probably is the case, certainly in Glasgow, that there can be a greater level of representation. But I stress it is in those cases where a view is taken, yeah. firstly by the parent they need representation, then by the solicitor that it's justified, and then by the Legal Aid Board in confirming that the test for it is met. So one only gets to the stage, in my view, where it's justified to have those okay. number of people there.
Tavish, I think that we could quite easily, we may be able to get figures from the yes. Scottish Legal Aid yeah. Board to see if there's yeah. been an increase over
no,
the
indeed.
Last few years.
I entirely take that point, Convener. Final question. You make very strong arguments, you've both made very strong arguments and correct arguments about chairing skills. Again, in your experience, Mark, do you see, I think Morag described that point very well earlier on, do you see examples where chairs of panels say, right, we've had enough of this legal stuff, stop? Does that happen in practice?
I stress that we're only talking about a minority before I give these examples.
Yes,
I have personally attended hearings where I've been told, you're not in the sheriff court, or I was even at a hearing where I was told, where I pointed out the legal test, because the approach was, this is what I think is in the child's best interest, and I pointed out, well, this is the test, and that's how you arrive at yeah. that. And I was told, well, I don't care about the law, the sheriff can fix that. Now that, you know, these are extreme examples, but the point is, these extreme examples don't just assist from solicitors behaving badly, they do exist in all ways, and that's why I think that the multidisciplinary collective training is really the way forward, because I think if we label one group as the problem, that's not going to do anything to foster improved relations. But those are just some very rare examples. By and large, the vast majority of panels are absolutely first rate. Yeah. They do their job well. We're talking about volunteers giving their time.
Exactly.
I have the utmost respect for these people. Mm-hmm. I think that, bearing in mind the system was initially designed with the Brandon report for child offenders by and large, and the care focus wasn't the initial focus, they are being put in an enviable position, because they're having to deal with increasingly complex cases in that care sphere. And that's why I say there's a need for a solicitor, but equally it makes it difficult for them, and no doubt they would benefit from training. That's not to say they're not doing the job properly, but who would say no to training that makes it easier for you to do your job?
Okay, thank you. Joy?
Yeah, my understanding is that panel members get first-class training as it is. I mean, any panel member I know that's ever spoken about going through the process have commented on just how good the training they do get is. Can I ask on the question of who you represent in a panel, when you say there's a mix, what proportion of the folk you represent are parents?
Well, I would say the majority we represent are parents. There are some dedicated firms that largely only represent children.
Is it the vast majority that are solicitors in the main, generally, in a panel system, represent parents?
Well, I think that's a different question. Obviously, from my perspective, in terms of how my firm represent people, the majority of them are parents, but there's a huge minority, perhaps 25%, that are children. In other firms, the split will be different. In terms of overall, across the board, who is being represented, I'm not sure I have access to that information. I would presume representation may be more frequent for parents rather than children. But in my view, that's an argument in favour of ensuring that children know they have the right to be represented when they feel they need to be represented, rather than an argument that parents shouldn't be represented. Because one of the concerns I have about one of the few concerns I have about the 2011 Act and the way it introduced funding was that it doesn't introduce automatic funding for children who have the competence to instruct a solicitor. So you're generally talking about someone who's 12 or above. If someone takes the view that they have capacity below that, obviously they can instruct a solicitor, but that's a value judgment. And I think this would be one of the tools which could be used to assist in dealing with this vexing issue of how do we ensure a child isn't lost in a hearing, because a child can effectively participate not just by being there, but also by ensuring someone's got their say. It's not just about a child's view, but when we're talking about older children, we're talking about children who have the right to participate more fully than just saying what they want.
The question was about the percentage of...
Yeah, but and that's maybe something we can find out. And I'm not... I mean, my sense from, I mean, I went and attended a hearing recently and was involved in the hearing system in a previous life, that having a lawyer speak for you doesn't necessarily mean that you're actively participating. It actually might mean that you're quite passive in the process, and I wonder whether there are skills that youth workers and advocacy workers might have that a solicitor might not have.
I think, actually, at the moment, the work that Scottish Government is doing to introduce advocacy, standard for advocacy workers is already taking care of this, because yes, there are times when a child does need legal representation, but I think most children who are able to work with someone to express a view probably would benefit more from the lay advocacy, because lay advocates have time that solicitors do not have. It's not legal knowledge that these children need for most hearings. It's understanding the process, taking time to go through the reports and the recommendations, that process of forming a view, which is what we want from children. So my feeling is that the more children have advocacy support, which is already in process and is going, and to a good standard, the better, because it doesn't matter if mum is represented by my colleague. If the child has a good advocacy worker, they're on a level playing field.
I'm not so sure about that, but that's one of the things we want to look at. I wonder, there's a point you made about vulnerability that I'll come back to in a moment, with your permission, but I wonder, now I might be getting this completely wrong, my sense of a solicitor, their job is to make the best case for their client. It's to make the best justification for the client of the circumstances they're in, when in fact one of the strengths of the hearing system in the past was that a parent could even refer their child to the hearing system because they need help and support, and that they in that circumstance might legitimately say, you know, I've got a problem here, there are things that I've done that I'm uncomfortable with, but I need help and I need support. From our discussions last week, my sense would be that a solicitor would gently touch you in the arm and say, don't say that. Is that wrong?
No, I think that is wrong, respectfully. I think it has to be remembered that the stage at which solicitors generally become involved is in cases where there's already becoming a divergence between the care plan and what the parent wants. We often will not be involved in the sense of participating at a children's hearing if, for example, the social worker have become involved and there are issues which the parent accepts and is able to resolve. And our approach is not to, in effect, take a combative approach to everything, quite far from it. One only takes that approach when that is the last resort. In effect, the starting point is to ensure...
What's the last resort? Is the last resort the possibility that the child will have compulsory measures of care?
No.
Which the parent wants to resist?
No.
Well, what is the last resort, then?
We're talking about a quasi-judicial panel, so I think we can't lose sight of the powers and decisions which can be made by these hearings. And that includes making a decision that a child is removed from a parent's care against the parent's wishes, or indeed against the child's wishes, and also preventing there from being any contact, albeit only for the duration of the CSO, but setting the child's care plan down a particular way. So what we're talking about, by and large, the cases where we become involved in relates to scenarios where a care plan of care out with the parent's care is what is being progressed. So if we're talking about representing a parent, that is where a parent will feel, I've tried to resolve this, not to the social worker or the professional agency's satisfaction. I feel that this has gone wrong or that has gone wrong, this is where I need representation. We're talking again about a minority of cases. I don't feel, to come back to the earlier point you had made, that a parent is disinhibited from participating in a hearing because a solicitor is there. As I said, parents are still encouraged to speak, and a good quality chairperson will say, I want to hear from you directly, what have you got to say? But there's a difference between, although you refer to it as participation, there's a difference between having your say and effectively participating. The latter concept is far wider because we're talking about very complex cases with complex circumstances in which a lot of work has to happen even before the parent gets to the door of the children's hearing.
So you think that at the point at which something very serious is going to be decided, that's deemed by the hearing system, the panel, to be in the interest of the child, is the point where a solicitor is necessary, who will then take a view about protecting the interests of their client, even if it's not in the interest of the child?
But again, I think that misses the point of the legislation, respectfully. The legislation has the underlying paramount consideration as what's in the best interest of the child. But that's not a tangible concept. Going into a case, there's not one answer as to what's in a child's best interest. The rules and the rigid regime which is set out in the legislation is aimed to guide panel members to arrive at that decision based upon all of the information they get, based upon everyone's contributions.
Your professional motivation will be to protect the interests of your client. Your client wants to keep the child with them. The hearing system is likely to say, this is not in the best interest of the child, and your job is to make as good a case as possible for that not to be agreed.
Well, I would hope that that decision is made by the children's hearing at the end, once my client, and again, we're talking about me representing a parent in this case, but once my client has effectively participated. The starting point is not that a child's interest and a parent's interest are in conflict. That is a decision that might arise, but that's something that has to be decided once everyone has been able to participate fully in this process. There may be cases where what I'm instructed to advocate for is something different. I think it has to be remembered that in dealing with this role, I'm a professional. I am not a mouthpiece for my client. So before I go into that, I give them advice. I digest the information for them. I tell them what the issues are, and we try and see whether what they're looking for is feasible. I don't go into a children's hearing saying my client, you know, for example, my client has been found to have sexually abused a child. He must have the care of this child. That's an extreme example, but it's not about simply advocating for our client's position at all costs. Yes, that's our primary role. And I think it has to be remembered, solicitors are in a unique position at a children's hearing because we are the only people who have to both represent a primary duty to our client, but also act in accordance with the best interests of the child at all times. No one else has that duality of obligation at a children's hearing.
It just feels to me there's a conflict there, and I'm not quite sure how that is resolved. Can I ask you something you said earlier? You said that all parents in the hearing system are vulnerable. Do you think that's true?
Well, I don't think I said all parents, but many of the parents which we find in this situation are vulnerable. I'm using vulnerability in the broadest possible sense. Ultimately, if we're talking about care cases, the very concept of that is that there is some perceived deficiency in the parent's ability to care for the child. So there is a vulnerability which requires to be addressed, or an issue which requires to be addressed.
So it may be that a parent who is neglecting their child, you would define that as being a vulnerability?
It depends on what the cause of that is. Remember,
I understand that. Yes. I understand that there are some people are in circumstances that are totally overwhelmed. They're not able to look after their child. The hearing system is geared for that. But if there's a presumption in your mind that all... You did... Maybe go back and check. What I heard was you saying all parents are vulnerable. All parents are clearly not vulnerable. They're perfectly competent, able, you know, articulate people who are very neglectful of their children, and it's not in the interest of the children to be with them.
Well, equally, I don't think all parents are neglectful of their children. We're talking about we're talking about a scenario of children who have been referred because there's an issue, and the focus is very much on care grounds, a lack of parental care, or an offence ground. Remember that a child can be referred to a children's hearing for all manner of reasons. There are an increasing number of grounds, quite properly particularised to identify what the issues are, set out within the 2011 Act. So my point is that the people who are meeting the test of representation, and again, we're coming back to the Scottish Legal Aid Board's competence test, the merits test, are people who largely will be vulnerable, because I have to answer four questions if I wish to persuade the Legal Aid Board that my client's case necessitates representation, and that's the test. The first is that I have to show that the case is factually complex. The second is that there are legal issues. The third is that there may be an issue with them being able to understand documents and digest those. And the fourth is about them being able to put their point across. So I have to address the very question you're highlighting to me in justification for being there in every case. So these issues are addressed. I'm still concerned that there seems to be a presumption that solicitors are a problem going into this hearing, even though I think you, Mr. Convener, had said that wasn't the view earlier on. I'm concerned that that seems to be the focus. I think the focus should very much be on accepting that there is a natural tension between parents having rights and children having rights, and ensuring how can we respect all of those, but with the child's interests as the priority, in a way which effectively protects all of those different interests.
Okay, can I ask that the answers are kept very brief, because we are coming towards the end of the session.
Okay,
thank you. Fulton, then Richard.
Thanks, Convener. Following on from John Lamont's line of questioning, would you accept that there are instances where the lawyer can be an issue in terms of the ethos of the children's hearing by their presence? Just, you know, as are occasions where you think that would be the case.
Are you saying that just by the nature of being a solicitor, you're...
Yeah, well, a solicitor coming along to a hearing... Because I suppose the point I was going to develop was... for me, it depends on who the solicitor's representing. You know, I think that you've made a really, really good case at the start of the solicitor when they're representing a child, and I've had experience of that as well. And I think that if a child's... you know, bringing in a solicitor then... pardon me, I've got a sore throat. A child's bringing in a solicitor, then that's fair enough. But when it's a parent who's maybe been accused or even convicted, and you mentioned an example yourself, Mark, of quite serious offences or allegations, and you've got a situation where a child is hearing, you know, a social worker, a teacher, panel members and various other people saying, you know, we're here to protect you. So I'm talking about the ethos of the hearing here. And then you've got another adult in the room who might seem to the child to be saying, you know, this is okay, in a child's mind, I mean. So what I'm saying is, I said last week on the record as well that I don't think that there's any circumstance where parents shouldn't be represented legally. I definitely don't think that. But I think the question comes back to where should that representation take place? And I suppose, back to my question, do you think then there is circumstances where the ethos of the children's hearing system can be taken away by the presence of a lawyer under such circumstances?
I think you're perhaps conflating two different things. If you have a person who is present at the hearing, whose very presence is causing such distress to a child, such as a parent who has been convicted of some form of maltreatment, whether it's physical, sexual abuse or other, there is provision for that person to be excluded for that part of the hearing. So that person and their representative will be told to leave. The child, we call them split hearings, they happen quite a lot. So the child can come in, out with the presence of that person, talk to the hearing, with or without the help of their representative. Hopefully they do have an advocacy worker or another representative. The child can then be excused from the other part of the hearing, and the problematic person can come back in and will be told what happened in their absence. So we have provision to reduce the number of people in the hearing that don't have a right to be there. We do have provision for excluding a relevant person and a relevant person's representative if it is going to make it impossible for the child to speak. Now, we could make that a little easier, because at the moment, you can only be excluded if it's going to make it impossible for the child to speak. Because, of course, what we're talking about is removing somebody else's rights temporarily, their right to be there. There is a balance there. But there are things we can do. You don't have to be there with your abusive parent and their representative. I'm finding that intimidating. You can leave the room for that period, and you can ask for them to be excluded when you go back in.
Yeah, and I accept that, and I accept the provision is there. And when the provision is used, it can work quite well. But I think that having sat through hundreds of hearings as well, like yourself, I think there's many instances where that doesn't happen. And actually, because some things can develop during a hearing, especially if it's an early hearing, things can come out that actually nobody suspected, and then before you know it, maybe the reporter, you've probably been in the situation where you're like, oh, well, you know, but before we know it, it can be too late. But so I suppose what I was just getting to there is I'm not disputing the role of legal advice or parents in such serious decisions, but I think I have to agree with the line of questioning John Lamont was taking. We've got a children's hearing system which is for the child, and therefore I do think that you know, that we need to find another way for parents to be represented legally that works.
Well, it may not always be necessary for legal representation, but there is inadequacy of advocacy services for parents as well across Scotland.
Yep. Thank you. Richard.
Thank you. Many of the questions I was going to ask have been addressed by other members. The only remaining one is clearly what forum exists where all the players get together and tease out the issues that you've been discussing today? Because you have said that there perhaps could be some improvements for mutual understanding of different roles and so on to have these issues addressed. What forum exists for that?
Well, the problem is there are different representative bodies for the different participants, so there may not be a forum that exists at this moment. What I think is required is ongoing dialogue as part of the work that's presently being done between these agencies with a view to probably creating a forum to allow that to happen.
Do you think it should be some kind of forum?
I think there should, as I said, and I hope it was clear, I think there should be interdisciplinary training, in effect, so that we all have a proper understanding. That may not solve every problem, but I think it will go some way to solving some of the concerns you have today. And if that doesn't resolve things, it will at least shine light on what the problem is after that. But I think there is an element of ignorance about the different roles, and it's difficult to unpick that without there at least being an attempt to try and resolve it first.
This is something that the Children's Hearing Improvement Partnership may be a good place to start.
Okay. Can I ask, are the Law Society represented on that?
No.
Okay. So maybe there's a wee bit of work to be done there. Sorry, Richard, were you wanting to second? Thank you very much. Ross, last speaker. Last question.
And actually follows on from a question that my colleague Liz Smith asked when she asked you around about potential improvements that could be made. And I saw in your submission you talked about there still being barriers to participation and that these can be improved upon. Now, the last bullet point, you talked about a requirement to provide a simpler version of reports to children, saying that this would make it easier for children to understand the information that they're being provided with. So, I haven't been in the Parliament previously. I'm new to this term, and I acknowledge there's been discussions. So can you talk me through exactly what is happening just now in relation to those reports? Are the issues round about the language, the presentation, the volume? And what is it you think that needs to be done to improve it?
Okay.
And what can this committee do to help that?
When I was a reporter, I would ask for reports for the hearing from the professionals. You'd get a 36-page social background report from social work, which takes about 18 hours to do, poor things. You might get a report from the school, you might get a report from a health visitor, any other mum's drug counselling, whatever. But they are written for the hearing, for the panel members. Copies are sent to the children from the age of 12. I suggested way back years ago that each report writer could be asked to do a very simple, no more than that, summary for the child of what they're saying and what their recommendations are. It could be as simple as, Billy, we're very worried that your mum is having a hard time looking after you properly, and we think you need extra help. And we're going to suggest that you live with your granny for a bit, or we think you should stay at home with mum. Just very, very simple. It wouldn't cost anything because the report writers are already doing the report. The teachers would be fab at it. Just something very simple. And I also suspect that for many parents who have a learning difficulty or a problem with English, that would be the report they would read. And that way the child would get something for the hearing. We could send it to the younger ones that would tell them very quickly and simply what that report was saying. Because at the moment, I can tell you the job of going through those reports with an adult client is tough, going through them with a youngster is really hard.
And that also protects them in terms of content, because if we're preparing a report for the benefit of a panel, it will have all of the information in it, warts and all, and they also have the grounds, which are the issues which led to them becoming before the children's hearing. So there may be an issue about protecting children from that information, because these reports are largely prepared on a rolling basis, which means part of it is a chronology. So every event, negative or otherwise, and often they're negative because that's the purpose of them, to highlight them, goes in that, so that the child is exposed to that in effect. And the reports, I know we were talking about 36 pages, but I've seen social work department reports in complex cases of over 100 pages. How is a 12-year-old child supposed to digest that?
So it's good. So you think that that's something that can be done quite quickly without
it
having to...
It could be done immediately if you just said any report submitted should have an age-appropriate short version for the child, unless the child is not able to understand even that.
Want to comment there, but thank you very much for that. Okay, that's the end of this session. Just before we go, I mean, it does seem like you've had a bit of an interrogation. The panel don't think the solicitors, by their very presence, are particularly bad things. The role of the committee is obviously to look at if there's anything that has to be improved in the children's hearing system, and that's why we're asking the questions that we are. So thank you very much for that, and that'll close the public session. Thank you.